Hey guys, this week on AwesomeCast, we're talking about a GoPro bag of holding. The iPhone strikes again. You can't steal it, guys. Cool maps for the Millvale Music Festival. Hey, Brian Crawford's in the studio from the River's Edge. That and so much more. AwesomeCast. This show is brought to you by Slice on Broadway, supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza, sliceonbroadway.com. And listeners like you, support this show at patreon.com/awesomecast.
Sidekick Media Services. We are your sidekick in business for social media, video production, and more. Find out more at sidekickmediaservices.com.
Hey guys, it's time to get geeky, talk tech. It's Mike Sorg at For the Awesome Cast in Mayhem Studios here in Pittsburgh, PA, the show where we talk about technology news and such with a Pittsburgh state of mind. We got a big crew here in studio. First of all, going over to the couch in studio, EA Sports, it's in the podcast. Chilla, as the dog has now got your attention.
How's it going, Chilla? Pretty good. How are you doing today?
Good. Of course, he's our gadget representative from Big Bank International Esquire.
I'm now a representative.
Representative? Sure.
I'd like to be a representative.
I don't know. We've just
I'm representing.
We added Esquire to your banks, so sure. why can't we just add to it? Yep.
I like this. Every week it's just something new. It's like the changing couch scene on The Simpsons.
Yeah, kind of. It's a it's a moment of self-discovery every time we start the show, right? And you probably saw over on video, Brian Crawford is with us once again. Ooh. Of The River's Edge, who thankfully carries this fine program as well as many others. There you go, representing with the shirt, of course. And of course, today representing MillvaleMusic.org, the Millvale Music Festival. And I think you're going to talk about that a little later, right?
We are, yes. We're very excited to be very tech-savvy. And I reckon that we are the most tech-savvy of the large music festivals in the city of Pittsburgh, and I'll tell you why a little bit later.
Fantastic. Let's bring your mic a little closer to you, actually. I'm going to mute you while we adjust that there. And also back with us is Katie Dudas, social media crazy person over at the Scare House.
Yes, shenanigans.
I really should write down your actual...
Just make it up. You can change it every week.
Yeah, we do for Chilla. So again, it's a moment of self-discovery for you. You haven't been on for several weeks. What have you been up to?
Oh, geez. What have I been up to? I think there was a hockey game, maybe. And I don't even know what else I was doing. Oh, I was in New York City. Oh, can't hear me. Get closer.
No, you're good.
I didn't hear you.
You pointed at me. I was like, oh, man.
I was about to, I'm gesturing because I was about to talk about you. there you go.
You gesturing in that manner.
Great episode of Scare House Podcast, talking with the Bricklage people.
Yes.
I was really enjoying that.
Okay.
I think I tweeted you guys. I was like, started this podcast as I was driving by the Bricklage on the other night, which was kind of weird. It was like, right over there. And I was noticing I didn't notice the new sign. I don't know how long they've had that, but... you can't miss it now. So go check out the Scare House podcast on your iTunes and what your podcatchers as well as hear what Katie's doing over there. So this is, like I said, the Awesome Cast. You can check us out at awesomecast.com. You can also drop us a line at on our awesome. Wait, my computer's going nuts. My computer's going insane. You can also hit us up on Twitter at AwesomeCast, Facebook AwesomeCast, and you can subscribe to us on your podcast, favorite podcast place, iTunes, Stitcher, Spreaker, iHeartRadio, and video versions on the YouTube and the Facebook and YouTube for the live feeds. And we're here live every Tuesday night at 7 p.m. Eastern Time, and we're also streaming over there on riversedgepgh.com and our friends at the 405media.com. So thank you to everybody supporting the show there. And also thank you to our Patreon supporters. Checking us out at patreon.com/awesomecast. Of course, Matt Weller at the Coffee Club $5 level. That's going to get a very interesting gold video this week that talks about Bluetooth and farts. What you're missing out on. And also thanks to Mike Fedor at the Fan of the Show $1 level. You can support many levels, including the $10 State of the Show level over at patreon.com/awesomecast. Let's get into the awesome things of the week. And geez, Brian, let's start with you with the Millvale Music Fest. So what is going on What is this technology laden music festival?
Yes, so we are very excited because you will be able to navigate the Millvale Music Festival via Google Maps. I reached out to a friend at Google and I asked, how can I make this happen? And he let me know about a feature that Google offers called My Maps, where you are able to develop your own map in your own directions in a Google Maps style. And then I've found a way to link that map to actually open it up in your Google Maps app. So if you go to millvalemusic.org, you will find the maps page and you can click that link and you can navigate it while you are at the festival. The map has different icons, which this is the cool part. So you can actually set up different icons and put pinpoints in different locations. It'll link up to Google Maps to actually put in different venues. So the different venues are marked with a star, and there are P's for parking locations, and then there is a blue line, which actually is a shuttle service that Z-Trip is providing, which will show you exactly where the shuttle is going, where to park, where the shuttle will pick you up, where it will drop you off, so that way you can make your plans. And then there is also a little taxi symbol, which is a taxi cab pickup. So on your way exiting the festival, there is a place where Z-Trip will be stopping by to pick you up from the festival in case you've filled yourself up on Dogfish Head, Trogues, Bell's Victory, Oscar Blues, or Grist House. You will be able to stumble your way to the taxi cab and be responsible on your way home. Not only that, Millvale has parking challenges, so this is one of the ways that we have tried to aid you in avoiding those challenges and figuring things out. So that is the biggest thing that I have to talk about. Also, we are looking at possibly putting our schedule up with Google Calendar, so that way you can create your own calendar, and that will come up once our schedule is released this Thursday at the Millvale Music, which you could find out. You can find that show on the Millvale Facebook page at Millvale Music. So we've done a lot with social media and with technology to try to make this festival as easy to navigate as possible and as user-friendly as possible, and I have not seen anyone else in Pittsburgh do anything close to this, so I'm really excited that we've, and I think that's one of the reasons why it's taken off as well as it has, is the use of social media and technology that we've used at the festival.
And I don't have a lot of history with going to music festivals in the city or anything like that, but I feel like geographically you guys are different because you're a contained,
yes,
you know, again, with those traffic parking issues and everything like that. I think that's a different kind of challenge than I think you see in like what Jazz on Walnut or whatever it is, right?
Well, I'll be honest, comparing to the other festivals that are similar to us, I think we have been very much on the forefront of considering these challenges. Maybe we have a few more parking challenges, which we've addressed with Z-Trip. But on the flip side, we're much more accessible for a person on foot. Most of our venues are within a 30-second walk from one another, yet we are still providing a shuttle service to places like Good Time Bar, the Sidelines, Barking Shark VFW area of town, and then the main part of town, and making those places walkable, whereas other festivals, even with the parking, maybe they have less parking challenges, which a lot of them still have parking challenges, you have to get into your car and drive to certain venues. You won't have to do that at the Millvale Music Festival. You could stop, get a shuttle, and bus yourself out to Good Time Bar instead of needing to walk that distance or get into your car and move yourself, which is something that no one else provides. And I think that is going to make this festival really accessible, and I think it's going to create a really great environment for people who are coming to view these bands.
And this is all in Google. Like, are these free tools in Google, or are
yes, My Maps is completely free, and it's mostly used for people, for businesses to show where they're at on a website, or it's used for people to share within their family, because you could share the My Maps with other people, and if you're planning a route or a travel route, then those people can kind of view that.
Races use this too, don't they?
I believe that they probably would. I mean, it would be crazy not to. The big thing with us is we've found a way, a link that will actually open it up in your Google Maps app, and then you're able to navigate it yourself, which I think is going to be a really awesome tool for people to be able to use.
That's awesome. And I think that the calendar seems really interesting, because then you could, you know, I can remember going to Warped Tour all these years and missing the band I really wanted to go because I couldn't get the schedule or where things are or anything like that. Here's a list and here's a stage. Where the hell is that stage, right?
That's the thing. You can add the stage to your calendar, and that's what we're hoping. Now, this is still in the works. We'll have that figured out by tomorrow. But you can add it to your calendar. It should ding. And then you can go to the Google Maps, find exactly where that location is, and then actually navigate to it with voice navigation through Google Maps.
That's awesome.
Yeah. It's going to be incredible. I'm really excited, and I think I just think that it's really going to make it a really great atmosphere for people. It's great for our venues. It's great for our sponsors, for people to be able to walk around and find out where these things are. And that's the nice thing about Google Maps is you can do foot navigation as well, which makes it nice. And I think, you know, and stay tuned, Millvale Music Minute. Throughout the weeks, we're actually going to be going through a tutorial to show people exactly how to use this service, how to navigate where the different venues are, how to use the Z-Trip code to get yourself a discount to actually take a Z-Trip car into Millvale at a discounted rate. So there's going to be a lot of information that's going to be coming out in the next few weeks as we approach the festival on May 13th.
That's awesome. We had a conversation on Awesome Chat with one of your co-organizers, Paul over there.
Yeah, he's the Swiss Army knife of the group. He does a bit of everything.
And we had a pretty good conversation about, because you guys, we could probably talk about a little bit here, you guys like exploded when you announced this on social media too. Like your Facebook page just had an audience jump on this thing.
It was actually such an overwhelming response that my phone died, and it usually would last till, I work overnight, it would usually last until the next morning, and it died before I even made it into work because it was just overwhelmed with notifications and messages and comments and likes and everything else coming through the Facebook page. And I've put together other large organizations before and other large events, and I've always been in a position where I'm trying to drag people in and try to coerce them to join the cause. And I remember going to team captain meetings with the Relay for Life, and every once in a while no one would show up, and we would take noisemakers and shake them into the hallways to try to drag people in and generate excitement, where this was the opposite approach, where everyone jumped on right away. And I thought to myself, oh man, what am I going to do to keep people coming back? Because if you peak too early, people can lose interest over the months.
So you have them that early, and it's more about, okay, great, now we have, you less concentrate on getting people, more concentrate on the organization.
Retaining them.
Well, the organization,
well, also the
too.
Organization. But I mean, that was always, you need the organization no matter what.
Yeah.
Whether you have people or not. Say you have an event and no one shows up, but it's poorly organized. Well, then they're not going to show up next year either. So the organization you got to work on no matter what. But the challenge that having such a large interest right away brings you is you have to try to maintain that interest all the way up to the festival, because as you know, if you get excited about something quickly, other things happen in life. It's easy to kind of lose interest, or maybe not even lose interest, but get distracted from what you're interested in. So the goal then is, how do you retain that interest? And I think that's where really my network with the River's Edge, we're one of the sponsors. I think it's where we came into play, where we used our technology to create live videos and kind of drop hints. As we started scheduling bands, we would kind of give teasers. All right, we're going to announce, you know, X amount of bands, and we would do that, and people would kind of wait to hear what's going on. And I think that has allowed us to sustain our interest throughout the festival, because people had content that they were able to watch, and I think that's really unique, and I don't think anybody else has anything quite like that. And that's one of the things that we've done to try to continue the interest. And that entire show was brought up literally because I had a little bit of a panic at first. I'm like, oh no, what am I going to do to keep people here? and that's why we put together that show.
No, that's great. That's great. Go check it out, and check out that conversation we had over on Awesome Chat as well. So let's go to Katie.
Yeah.
Are you ready?
You
changed yours. Wait, yeah. There you are. What is your awesome thing of the week?
Big shout out to Chilla for this one.
Cross the cows to Chilla.
Yeah, Chilla. Thanks. You're like, this is thanks. So the real doll, which has been around for about, it's been almost 20 years now. It's a very realistic sex doll, if you're not familiar with the real doll. But now they have Harmony 2.0, and she talks and has 18 different personality options. It looks like she has a Scottish accent, which is kind of funny. But she can be anywhere from shy to very sexual. And she will talk to you about, she'll learn your favorite things. Like, she'll have conversations with you. For example, one of the questions they have is, you might say, I'm hungry, what should I eat? And she would say, well, you told me pizza is your favorite food, maybe you should have that. So not only are you getting a very realistic looking person, now you got a personality in this real doll, which is pretty cool, actually, that they're able to apply this technology here. But they, if you look at the videos or any of the screenshots, they look like real people. There's girls and there's a couple male models.
So is this, wait, I'm kind of confused. Is this, so the Harmony Artificial Intelligence, like it's saying that it's an app here? Or
yeah, you have to get the app.
You have to get the app and then it interfaces with your real doll.
Correct.
That you, yeah, everybody has one, right?
Yes. of course. It's $20 a year to get the app.
Oh, that's...
And you can get just the app.
Yeah.
You don't have to get the doll.
So if you just need somebody to chat with, you can just get the app. Mm-hmm. And
the interesting thing I saw is scroll up just a little bit, a little bit more, a little bit more.
Is that the
spot? Yeah. A little bit more. Where'd the thing go? There was a thing with like hexagons right there.
Oh, yeah. There.
So if you remember the tuning for it,
you know what this reminds me of? Remember Apple Music?
That's what I was going to say.
Yes.
It's like Apple Music. You
Apple
tap
Music
on like
sex dolls.
Like what you want, and that's
oh,
that's
do
how
I want
it
somebody moody, quiet, imaginative, AI. Jealous.
But if you don't get the doll, though, I mean, if you just need someone to talk to, doesn't it seem kind of like sad?
Well, and the interesting
let's put sad aside for this conversation a little bit.
And I really wonder, like, how many people that have purchased the real doll thought, I just wish this thing could talk.
Yes.
I'm not sure if that was the driver to purchase, but maybe. Mm-hmm. It's a very interesting take for me on AI, because building how that's going to interact with people is going to be a lot more complex than something like Siri, who you really have to engage with and it performs an operation, or Cortana, who tries to prejudge what you may want and carry out some specific tasks. To me, this is much more of the, hey, let's start a conversation. How's your day going? That kind of thing. So I'm interested to see what they can learn from this. This has much better chance of becoming Skynet than, to me, Siri, Alexa.
Oh, sorry.
Or
you said Skynet. Us.
that's the max startup sound of Skynet.
Now, see, you mentioned, Chilla, that you were wondering, you know, people who maybe just got the doll but didn't not get the app were wondering, you know, about getting the person to talk. I wonder how many people got the app or like, man, I can't get her to shut up.
Showing this video?
Oh, wow, yeah.
Because, I mean, it's very, I mean, I guess it's out of, yeah, okay. New York Times.
It's like designing a female sim on the app. And then, like, you know how you had the social and kind of that little...
But the sim, like, becomes a real, like,
yeah, friend
sized person made of silicone.
Well,
you can be, yeah.
They're going to build it, I think they're going to build it in VR as well.
Mm-hmm.
So you're going to be able to put her in a VR state without having the doll as well, which is kind of an odd.
That's weird.
Well, yeah. The social meter, the value fluctuates based on how often and for how long you interact with your AI. So the more social you are with it, the more social it'll be with you.
Mm-hmm. So it's also like a Tamagotchi if you don't take care of it.
I forgot to feel like my real doll. Now she's mad. Yeah. I'm sorry, my real doll is hangry. I can't come into work today.
So instead of calling it Tamagotchi, they will call this one Tamagotchi.
Tamagotchi. Well, there you go. You can go to robotics.systems and find out some more information there.
Learn all about Harmony.
What's that?
Learn all about harmony.
Yes. Chilla, what's your awesome thing?
So my awesome thing of the week is, and it actually someone brought it up in my Facebook feed yesterday, at the Coachella event, it looks like someone got caught with over 100 stolen cell phones.
Jeez.
Primarily because multiple people realized their cell phone was stolen and all fired up Find My iPhone from other people's phones simultaneously and pretty much flocked to this.
Wow. Oh, geez. Is this a picture of the phones?
Yes.
Holy crap.
I think it was over 100 phones. It was 100 or over phones that the person had been stealing throughout the festival. And when people realized that their phones were stolen, like I said, they all fired up their Find My iPhone, and I'm sure some people with Find My Android device app, and then all started tracking this person. Police detained the gentleman, I think, from New York.
Mm-hmm.
And apprehended him. People got their devices back. It's interesting because in this, they also revealed in the news article, They also revealed that Apple has patented some additional capabilities into the Find My iPhone, where it will take, based on the gyroscope, if the, when the phone's picked up, it'll fire a couple photos. It'll activate the rear-facing camera to record where the device is, along with its geolocation, in addition to actually recording the fingerprints that are swiped across the home button. So if you did recover your phone but couldn't find the person, there's residue of their existence and who they potentially are on the phone. It would then capture all that data. I'm guessing, I don't know if you would have to Apple to give it over to authorities, or if you could provide some kind of zipped up archive of all the information about the person that stole your phone, which I think is pretty cool. It's also interesting when I was reading, you know, you read the news article and then you read all the comments, and everyone's like, why aren't thieves smarter nowadays? Why didn't he just turn off all the phones as he collected them? They wouldn't have been able to phone in. What did he think he was really going to get away with? But I thought it was a good use case for, again, a multitude of devices being recovered at a large festival like this.
I just don't know why you would steal a phone. I mean, like, nowadays you can get a phone, everybody who's on welfare has a smartphone. It's not like it was back in the day where if you had a smartphone, you were, like, really, you know, high tech.
I think they still take them to shops like Ninja Entertainment and just try to resell them. And if let's just say he got $20 a piece for them at $100 or at 100 phones, that's a decent little thievery payday.
I love that feature with Apple, though. That's really clever. I know my personal phone, we have a business account with the network, the River's Edge, and I have it logged in as a business phone, so I can actually wipe the phone completely clean if somebody is to steal my phone right from the PC, all of the files, the information, everything, which is kind of cool.
Yeah, that is cool. And then I've seen on the new Galaxy S8, and I'm guessing it's going to come back to a couple of the other devices, there's a secured folder.
Oh.
And you can actually take all of your apps and put duplicates of them with even different accounts in the secured folder. There's an additional gallery, additional notes, additional everything. You can put a different set of contacts. And the only way, even if you could break into the phone, then you got to break into the secured side of it as well.
Okay.
With additional PIN, passcode, fingerprint, whatever. That it kind of allows you to take your important data and put it over here, and then take your really important data and put it over here. And it kind of gives you an extra layer of security for that too. So it's pretty cool. And you can also remotely wipe just the secure container without wiping the phone side of it. It's pretty neat technology from Samsung.
Nice.
Wow. So don't steal phones at a very, you can't do it anywhere. Any event like that is just going to be filled with cell phones.
Well, yeah. And so, I mean, you look at like activation lock now with Apple and I know Android devices are picking it up.
I just turned on two-factor authentication on my iPhone. So, yeah. I mean, that's, because I almost will always have two devices around me. So, you know, it works, right?
Mm-hmm.
So. All right. My awesome thing is I have a new GoPro bag of holding. I'm calling it.
How many GoPros fit in there?
None, because of the way it's set up right now. So I wanted to try to use some GoPro for a show that was happening last weekend or 2 weekends ago, I guess. And I hit up Katie here and asked if I could use their kind of doodads and everything, and they sent me their case, and Aaron said that you know, this is like $15-$20 on Amazon, this little bag. Okay, so I want to show you guys, this is a little more visual here, but how much stuff comes in this? I think I paid $15 for this. Here, well, it's upside down. So that's
how much stuff can spill out of this.
If you look at all this stuff.
Wow.
I don't even know what half of this is. It's falling out. Wow. It's everywhere. Everywhere.
Hopefully it's not fragile.
It's every connector, because you know how GoPro has like their own connectors and everything. Mm-hmm. It has like everything you could possibly think of for this. I spent like $8 on a suction cup thing for my car, and there's another one of those in here.
Wow.
I took that out. But you know, stuff to connect to a you know, to vice onto a banister or something here. So here's the tip. Even if you don't have a GoPro, which you can get really cheap these days, just like the low-end one, just to have a GoPro to try to get some really interesting shots. There are adapters in here, like this one, that will work just fine with the little one here. The little connectors for like your iPhone or say for a 360 camera or something, if you want to put it in an interesting spot. So even if you don't have a GoPro, looking up one of these kits may be worthwhile because there's so many things in here. It opens the possibilities of what you can attach those to. Now, I wouldn't be using the, I don't know, chest thing to wear your iPhone on maybe while you're playing football or the, you know, or your 360 or something like that. Or the, hold on a second. I mean, I don't know if your iPhone you'd want to use the flotation device with unless you got the, you know, nice underwater case. You know, by the way, the underwater cases, they were selling like big time in Thailand when we were going like,
oh, I'm sure,
like snorkeling and stuff. And they're basically just the bags that you put them in. Mm-hmm. But everybody had them tied to their wrist and they were taking pictures underwater and everything. Like it was, it's basically just it's like a vinyl bag case thing that any phone could fit into, but it was waterproof. If you had something.
So all that stuff comes in that bag?
Yes. Yeah, absolutely.
That's how much incredible. Is that? How much is it?
It was like 15 bucks, 15 to 20 bucks.
15 bucks.
15 to 20 bucks. And it's like, and I'm not even like a bag of every little connector you'd want and sticker thing. And you always lose. Katie, back me up here. You always lose these little screw thingies.
Yes, those are such a pain. Yeah, right?
And if you've I had like the two that came with my GoPro and another one that came with like a selfie stick that I got. And because it was kind of seconding as a tripod for it. And, you know, this, if you need something with a bunch of joints to put it somewhere, you know, it's everything you can think
of. We lost one of those screws for our tripod at the studio.
Yeah.
For the webcam. So we literally, for a while, had a pastry sticking in the tripod to keep it level so that way you could see it. It's now been replaced with the cap of a 5-hour energy drink. Ooh. So, yes.
Got another selfie stick here.
So what are these? What is this called?
It's, just look up GoPro accessories and you will find several bags. It'll just look for a picture of a bag and or just one of those things that's just a like every accessory you can think of. I'm sure not everything was pictured here.
So it's not actually a GoPro bag of holding.
It sort of is because everything's GoPro compatible.
So, but they should market it as a GoPro bag.
It should be a GoPro bag of holding. I know.
So there's a 50 in one. How many are in there?
I'm not counting.
There's 55 in one.
Which one did you get?
I don't know which one I got. Hold on. Let's see. Scott McTaggart's in the chat room. He says he's just here for the bag of holding. So there you go. The GoPro bag of holding. Do not search GoPro bag of holding. It will not come up with what you think it will.
I used to work for this retailer. You mentioned the thing for your phone that would hold your phone. And they used to come in and do like the secret shoppers that they do at retailers to try to like trick you up to see if you answered all the right questions. Well, they did audio and video, but it was so easy to spot them because they were always completely squared up with you everywhere they were walking and everywhere you were trying to show them something, they would kind of move around with their chest out, kind of like with the camera trying to point it right at you. And it was pretty entertaining to watch the reviews because they would send you actually the video after the fact and they would tell you what you did wrong and they would send you the video and the audio.
And the thing is, it's so easy because you can take, like, if you have like a 6S size phone or bigger and you have a chest pocket, like it can fit right there with the lens out that, you know, not directly, but not bad. Okay, the one I bought is the Baxia Technology, Baxia Technology, 44 in one accessories for GoPro Hero, blah 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 blah, and it was $16.49 for the one. Is that about, Katie? You said you got one and you just had taken a lot of the stuff out of there.
Yes, I think that's the one I have too.
Is this exactly the right one?
Does that chest piece, will it actually work with a phone or do you have
It's the adapter for the GoPro. But because you have all the adapters that go into the regular connector for a tripod, you can connect anything to that.
Okay.
Because
my thought process is I've been thinking like for Easter and whatnot and those then going to the beach with Christopher, I'd like to use an old phone and strap it to his chest for his point of view of everything,
because the Google Glass doesn't fit on him, right?
Yes,
yeah,
no. That doesn't fit. So this would be nice, but I gotta find a way to mount the. I either gotta buy a GoPro now, or I gotta figure out a way to mount that phone.
Duct tape,
lots of
just throw the Gear 360 on his chest. you know, then you'll get everything.
Well, that'll be mounted to his head.
Why is he got, he's gonna have like a beanie cap, but it's got like this ball on the top, right? Or you know, like the stocking cap that has like the poof ball on the top instead of the GoPro, the Gear 360 sticking up there. So, all right, guys. Hey, let's give a shout out to our good friends in pizzadom. Our friends at Slice on Broadway, sliceonbroadway.com. Supporting. Oh, wait. We got Brian over there showing off. There you go. Loving it. Eating it. Yes, we are for real with this pizza. Check them out. SliceOnBroadway.com. PGH_Slice on the Twitter and Slice on Broadway on the Facebook and the Instagram. And he's munching. He's munching over there on the microphone. There you go. The radio professional. And thank you to them supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza here in Beachview, Carnegie, PA on Main Street and PNC Park, home of the Pittsburgh Pirates, who are back in season. Go visit them. Let them know the Awesome Cast sent you. All right. We got a few things lined up here. First of all, just because I was already looking at my Amazon page, there was somebody, I think this was a feature also on the new screensavers this week. They were talking about it on Twitter, but let me see who posted this. Who's talking pancakes this week?
That was Riz.
That's Riz, our friend Riz. Like Riz. Riz plays games. Give him a shout out for that. But you can go for $300, have your very own pancake printer.
Oh, yeah, that's so cool. And you know what? I was reading that before I came in, and I was like super excited because I'm a Trekkie, and this is like the beginning of the replicators.
Wait.
Well, if they can freaking make pancakes out of a machine, eventually they'll be able to, like, you'll be able to go get your Raptogino out of the coffee. They'll be able to make Klingon Raptogino in a freaking machine, and I could just go up to the machine and ask for a Raptogino, and it'll zoom, and it'll be there. I'm excited about this. Like, I'm super excited about this pancake. This pancake making. Yes.
We're showing the video on Amazon's page right there, here. So it will print things in shapes.
But they actually use batter.
They use batter.
You can eat it, right?
It's a pancake.
That's what I mean. That's the future. That's a machine creating food for you. That is the first step towards Star Trek.
Okay, but it's one material. It's pancake material, right? Everything starts with something. Okay, so I mean, we got our dinosaur pancake. They're on the other show. They're making like people's faces with the pancakes. There's an Einstein pancake. You want to eat Einstein's face? Maybe it'll make you smarter, guys.
It can't hurt.
Maybe him.
I am so thrilled about this. Like, you have no idea. I saw that and I just like, I got giddy. I just thought, you know, this is so cool. This is like, I can
print out your logo on here and, like, you know, we could have a special podcast pancake breakfast with logos of our shows on there. Well, right?
They just said that there's a moon on Saturn which could potentially host life. So we could move to Saturn and eat computer generated pancakes. That is the future. Right there.
There you go.
Well, I'm wondering why they can't. So it looks like there's some kind of reservoir on the top that has the batter in it, right?
Right.
If you put some kind of dough type batter in there and printed out the pizza shell, and then another one, like if you had, like, I'm imagining like six of those reservoirs with like tomato paste and cheese, liquid cheese.
So you're saying we need a pancake or a pizza printer?
You could do with a pizza printer.
See, he's thinking Star Trek. I like his thinking.
We don't get Slice on Broadway.
Well, Slice uses the pizza printer.
Yeah, exactly.
Places like Slice.
It's kind of like, remember the craft beer Keurig of craft beer thing, the Pico Brew? Like, it's like that. Like, you perfect the Slice on Broadway recipe for pizza making. You sell this packet. You put it in the pizza bot. And then you have Slice on Broadway pizza. We can finally send that pizza to Bobby F. J-Town on Wheels.
It's like the lemonade. Yeah.
Not only that, don't you think that a company that's as forward-thinking like Slice on Broadway, which sponsors podcasting, the next generation of media here for all of us who are listening, don't you think they would be at the forefront of pizza technology? Don't you think they would be the pioneers of something like a Star Trek-esque pizza maker?
they were already making pizzas in the shapes of Hello Kitties for Katie's birthday.
I rest my case.
Yes. Absolutely. So there you go, Pancake Bike. Thank you, Riz.
And I'm
Riz
sorry, Bogues. I was really excited.
No. I loved how you peeked up. Like I was like, I don't know if it was on camera, but he just was like,
I remember reading that before I came in, and I got a little excited. I swerved a little, you know.
If you're ready for sad, confusing news, Nintendo is discontinuing the NES Classic Edition for some reason. They, in the same vein, apologized for people having trouble finding the unit, and but I said, By the way, final units are going out, and that will be all that's going out there. I know Mad Mike, who works at a Toys R Us up around Poughkeepsie, found three there and asked if anybody wants them, because it's probably the last chance you'll get. So kind of sad, because it was a nice little thing. Supposedly, one of the kind of rumors or the guesses going around is that they basically released this thing more for marketing value than actually selling it and making money, which I could believe.
I understand the desire to market, but the thing sold out everywhere, and everyone wanted one during the holidays. They were in short demand. They still seem in somewhat short demand. I don't necessarily understand why, unless they were selling them at a loss.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Even if you were
how for $60.
Exactly. Well, I'm just saying, if let's just say they were, which I don't think they were.
It's a Raspberry Pi with Nintendo games that are officially licensed. That's basically what this thing is.
And that's where I wonder. Like,
there's one there hiding behind Brian.
If you were making a Raspberry Pi or
a Raspberry Pi.
If
I had one of these, that would be proudly displayed wherever I could.
Can
put
I
it.
Eat the Raspberry Pi?
No, don't eat the Raspberry Pi.
Even if they were making $5 a piece. Why wouldn't they just continue selling it till they had market saturation?
I know. Yeah. What in the last 20 years of Nintendo has made sense marketing wise?
And one of the things that I wonder is, did they, how many games were on it?
30?
30, so that's like $2 a game.
And it was now also, it wasn't all just Nintendo games. Like, it was a mix of Ninja Gaiden and Mega Man. Like, it was a bunch of stuff. So they did have to license all that stuff. That's the only thing I can think of.
But you're licensing games that are 20 years old.
They sell them for $10 a piece on the virtual console.
Well, so that's what I'm wondering is, are we going to see, are they really going to make a push and say, hey, if you like that device, you'll love the Switch?
As it is, as by the way, I've got my hands on the Switch last week, and not that there was much on it to be played, but I kind of like that.
Well, the thing that I didn't understand about the Switch is, did you see the Switch sales versus the Zelda sales?
More Zelda copies have been sold than Switches. And yes. that, to clarify, that was the Switch version of Zelda, right? Because there is a Wii U version. But
yes,
it was
the Switch version.
So they sold more of a single game for the console than the console.
So, and I'm wondering, because I've seen Zelda on sale at like Target and whatnot for the Switch, but obviously there's no Switches to be bought. So I wonder if people are just buying the game.
It's kind of a
hoping that one day they'll get a Switch.
So they can just stare at it and you know, I understand if you had it, like you wanted to get the collector's edition, but yeah, that's weird. That's weird. Mm-hmm. It shows how not supported a massive audience is. In Nintendo's world, right? Like this, I don't know. I don't know if it's popularity by scarcity or by design, or if they just are not putting things out the right way.
I don't know, because I mean, GameSpot wrote an article that said based on current supply and demand, they see the demand lasting through Christmas, which seems like bit of a lengthy.
That was the dog. Just you heard something. That was the dog, not something else.
It was chill. Did my Bluetooth just go out?
Did your Bluetooth just go out?
I'm just joking.
But I mean, I think that's a bit of a long run if you're trying to create scarcity.
Right.
I mean, you're practically into the planning of the next console.
You can't figure it out by then.
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, Apple figures it out in 2 months. Yeah. Right. Like yearly. So
yeah, I think they're making a terrible mistake. You look at the world right now and people are so into retro gaming. That's why all of these companies exist, like the Exchange and Cash and Culture locally here in Pittsburgh and all of these other buyback stores, and why they're so successful. People want those old games. I think as much as the new games are so technologically advanced and pretty to look at, a lot of times, like I personally see them, and they don't look like games to me anymore. They look like playing a movie. And I think sometimes people want to just play an old game, something that looks like a game, sounds like a game, and looks like a game, you know? And I think that's why that retro culture exists. And I think people, even if it is a raspberry that you can't eat in a pretty shell, people like having that on their counter.
I mean, show you the Raspberry Pi after the show now. So I don't know if it's going to change your perceptive or anything like that, but exactly. We'll see. There was a story here shared by, missed who shared it. Where is it at? Ryan, our friend Ryan Haggerty, shared this, who's going to be on the show next week, actually. And this was all over a lot of the podcasts that I was listening to. I'm sure you guys heard it too. But prison inmates built a working PC out of e-waste, networked them, and hid them in a closet ceiling. Look at that beautiful piece of technology right there. At first, I thought it was one of those phone things that you see in old buildings, like those phone directories. But yeah, they were stealing credit cards in this thing. It's amazing. Wow. It was inside of Ohio's Marion Correctional Institute. Yeah, they just smuggled in enough parts to get that in. They were in the network for the correctional institute and everything. This was incredible. So, they were doing something illegal, but you have to admire the ingenuity of this thing.
Did they say how they actually built it, or what it was? It was built out of e-waste, I understand, but does it say like where they got the scrap, how it all worked?
I think some of them do go a little bit more into their they were at this. Hold on, here's a quote in here. It surprised me that the inmates had the ability to not only connect these computers to the state's network, but had the ability to build these computers. They were able to travel through the institution more than 1,100 feet without being checked by security through several checkpoints, and not a single corrections staff member. At some point, you need to bring in a motherboard, right?
Or a Raspberry Pi.
Or a Raspberry Pi. It looks a little bigger than a Raspberry Pi, but they probably could have gotten away with it, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. But anyways, that was some good stuff.
Maybe they hit a Raspberry Pi within a Raspberry Pi.
So the authorities were first tipped off to a possible problem in July when their computer network support team got an alert that a computer exceeded a daily internet usage threshold. When they checked the login being used, they discovered an employee's credentials were being used on days he wasn't scheduled to work.
So how is it that inmates in a prison, locked up, are able to build this? Yet Facebook can't even allow me to approve a post on my wall via my phone with their team of tech people and in programmers.
So my question is this something we're going to see on the Orange is the New Black?
Oh, yes. That's coming in at least the next season, right? Katie, have you been following the Wendy's and Hardee's trolling incident?
Oh, my gosh.
Katie, do you want to fill us in on what's happening here?
Okay, let me see if I remember what happened correctly.
The headline is Wendy's trolled Hardee's so hard on Twitter they got blocked.
I have to see the starting tweet because I don't want to totally tell the story wrong. Because what happened was, because Wendy's has been trolling everybody, which is just fantastic. Yes. So it was a conversation about a 4-for-4 deal. And somebody said Wendy's 4-for-4 was the better deal. Hardee's was the 4-for-4 better deal. And so they're like, somebody just asked Wendy's. And Wendy says, we usually prefer the original to a knockoff, but hey, you do you. Hardee's said, just because you were the first doesn't mean you're the best. Wendy says, tell us the fourth person to walk on the moon without Googling it. And then they got blocked. But so like Wendy's has totally been trolling people left and right, and it's just amazing.
The weird world of fast food social media has been great. By the way, DiGiorno is apparently officially a sponsor of WWE, so the wrestling tweets are back again. I'm very happy about that on Monday nights and pay-per-view nights. They were really big over WrestleMania, I know. So, all right. VR. We haven't had a VR story in a couple weeks. How about Dragon Ball Z VR?
Ooh.
Did you guys see the video for this thing?
I have not.
I love, because it's a 2.5-minute video, and the first half of it is just like everybody pantomiming, and the dad is like all about doing this VR. And it's basically like a Google Cardboard kind of setup, right? Where it goes into this thing and you have it, but there's these sensors that go on your hands, and he's in his socks, ready to go, and he's ready to throw Kamehameha. Damn it. I'm looking at the word. It doesn't make sense in my head. I swear I watched this cartoon, right? But yeah, he's making the motions and everything. And I guess in they do eventually give you a little bit. This is definitely a pre-rendered version here because there's no way it's that good that you see your feet. But yeah, you're in there and you're fighting Frieza and everything. You can see, you know, the worlds. So it's a nice toy VR. Use your phone. It's in Japanese. It's very in Japanese. They show a little bit of kind of AR. He's blowing up his living room. He's targeting his small child. So you're flying. He's
so happy.
He's so happy with this.
This is the best day of his life.
It is. It is.
The birth of that child.
So it's.
I brought you into this world, and I can take you out of it.
Basically. So it's kind of like they took VR, AR, and laser tag. I think, because I think you will be able, they don't show it here, but I feel like you're going to be able, from the presentation, like, kind of interact with other people with this thing.
Hmm.
So it goes for about $110 or 12,000 yen. It's, of course, Japanese, very Japanese, for a magical VR experience.
I just feel like sooner or later we're going to see people that just sit on their couches in VR helmets and they just never leave.
It's
like
their real doll.
With their real doll.
Are we going to bring up that other story? About another thing you can do from your couch? Maybe some other time. okay. Did you guys look at the F8 announcements today?
Yes. Well, Facebook's.
Facebook, yeah, of course. So what kind of got you guys' attention out of this?
Two things came up that caught my eye were there's updates to Messenger. Mm-hmm. With support for QR codes now.
Oh, yay!
Food delivery.
All right, real quick, though. There's updates to QR codes, but what did they take away or what did they mess up in the process? Because anytime they add something, they seem to destroy five other things in the process.
Who knows? But there's Messenger codes now, so instead of when you're out and about, you could scan and join.
Oh, like Snapchat does.
Yeah, I didn't say that.
What?
Chat extensions. Now there's these things where you can watch brands like Spotify, The Score, Open Table, Food Network, which very similarly looks like some other social media platform.
They're very defensive today, I understand.
Yeah. But something cool that is kind of fun that it pops up automatically in Messenger. If somebody says something to you, it kind of reads what it says and gives you the responses with stickers. Like when people message me happy birthday, I noticed thank you, all the little thank you graphics popped up that I could return stickers with.
Oh,
that's very nice.
So it's contextual a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
That's cool.
They changed the gaming a little bit. But the other big thing was Spaces. It's a whole new VR thing. They want you to, it's only in the Oculus because very small number of people could actually use this because of the way they're set up, Oculus Rift and Touch.
Mm-hmm.
But you go through this whole process of selecting your own look, how they take a picture and they try to figure out what facial features they see. And so you build your character and you have these VR discussions with your friends and you can draw in 3D and then share your drawings. And then you can have somebody come in and like the video chat and put a beard on them and things, you know, filters, very similar to another social media site.
So it's generating it from the pictures, it looks like here. Mm-hmm. That's pretty cool.
Hmm.
And then now you're in this world and this is the weird floating torso cartoony thing that we saw with, you angering the dog over there again. We saw with Mark Zuckerberg a few months ago. But again, like the 3D drawing, we played with a little bit of that on the Vive with the Google Pixel brush, I think it is. This is pretty cool. Like if this is like kind of as intuitive as it looks like, this could be a pretty fun kind of.
This could be how we do AwesomeCast.
Exactly, right? So yeah, we no reason to come to a studio anymore, right? Mm-hmm. So it's pretty cool.
But yeah, the one thing Mark Zuckerberg said, which was interesting, was that virtual reality won't be something that won't see its full potential until another 10 years. Hmm. And there's 30 to 50 Facebook employees working on social VR right now.
Wow. That's awesome. Chilla, what caught your attention from?
The thing that caught my attention was that he brought up a pair of easy to wear standard looking glasses and talked about a lot about augmented reality. why buy a physical TV when you can buy a $1 TV app that can place the TV anywhere? Think of your glasses in AR. I could say, I want this whole wall to be a TV. I want this to be a different TV, etc.
Kind of like how you can take your VR and just watch Netflix on a giant screen, right?
Yes.
So
pretty much.
So there's good and bad to that. So I'm excited about that concept, and I'm really excited about the idea of being able to like see something in the movie theaters, but not going to the movie theaters, because I like to sit at home and drink a beer and watch the movies. But at the same time, I remember growing up as a kid, and we had one TV in the house, and it was in the living room, and you were forced to watch whatever dad was watching, and that was family time. And I feel like, you know, like, that was family time, dang it. And, and without family time, I don't know. I don't know what else we would have done together if we didn't sit around and watch TV.
But I think you will be watching TV. It's just you'll be watching what you want to watch. And
You're all in the same room with your screen in front of you.
But at the same time, then are you actually communicating? Because if I'm watching what I want to watch, and dad's watching what he wants to watch, and my sister's watching what she wants to watch, and mom's watching what she wants to watch, then none of us are talking about what we're watching because we're all involved in what we're watching. And then you have nothing to really talk about at the dinner table.
I think
because
the isolating thing is the, you know, hey, we're all going to have this thing in our face, you know, and you're not going to have that shared experience.
Exactly.
Right? Yes. And that is a concern, I think, a little bit. Because I actually got to think about this other day. Like, you know, if we had kids and you know, I remember, again, you had three channels, right?
Mm-hmm.
When it was after 8 o'clock, you watch whatever. Like, for what reason, I remember watching something like Designing Women, you know, when I was, I don't know, eight. You know, or Golden Girls or something like that,
Murphy
right?
Murphy Brown.
No, Murphy Brown, big time in my household, right? You know, or Jeopardy or Wheel of Fortune or the news because there was nothing else going on. You know, versus like kids today are probably going to grow up on Netflix for Kids on their iPad while dad watches whatever. And they're not going to be exposed to certain things in that same manner. You know, it was just an idea that popped in. But it's interesting because what you see, you always see, see other people with kids like you in public or some of our friends, and the kids have an iPad or an iPhone that's theirs that they're watching YouTube videos on or you know whatever they want, and I don't know if that's better, you know, at that age.
We have it's interesting too though because we have the TV on, and usually it's playing something, but usually you also have that device in front of you. I mean, how often do you really sit down? And
that's just the way it rolls these days.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, I just remember growing up, like, we didn't even have a TV in the bedroom, and we weren't allowed to have a TV in the bedroom. And when I moved back home after college, my dad asked, hey, do you want a TV in the bedroom so you don't have to sit down here? And I'm like,
They weren't up to it.
No, I said, yeah, they did, but I'm like, why would I have a TV in the bedroom? That's stupid. So, I don't know. I feel like, you know, if you have a TV in the bedroom, it's the same type of idea where you're watching what you want to watch. You're not socializing with the family, you're kind of off in your own world, and I don't know. I actually thank my parents for not allowing me to have a TV in my bedroom because I feel like that was something that I'm able to remember, and I felt like that was time that I was able to connect with them. Where, you know, my friends probably didn't have as close of a relationship with their parents because they were never with them. They were always in the bedroom watching TV or they were out doing whatever. And here I spent nights sitting on the TV watching Cops or whatever stupid show my dad wanted to watch because that's what he was into.
But how did you play video games?
I didn't, and I really don't play video games to this day, so I never really had an interest.
I had a TV in the bedroom, but I was only allowed to use it like 1 hour a day.
Mm-hmm.
So like I got an hour a day.
That's cool, I think. Yeah,
to use a TV, I could go in, use a TV, I could use it to watch TV or play video games or do whatever. And my 1 hour was up, and that was on weekends too. Mm-hmm. And then you were in with the family.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know. I guess I look at Kindle and stuff like that today and different, I mean, limiting screen time and ways of limiting screen time. I think there's ways to do it and keep the family centric side of it together.
I think you said it. I think a lot of it comes down to moderation because they say that people who like kids. Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, that's all right.
I talk with my hands. They say, do you want me to touch this?
Yeah, just push it in.
Okay, they say that, you know, kids who have iPads and they get a chance to play with that, they can discover, and it's something where they can kind of train themselves even at a young age to do different things that can help them later in life. But if you allow them to become addicted to it, then they mm-hmm. see the screens and it affects their sleep schedule and it can affect other issues as well. So I think you're right. It has to do with maybe moderation mm-hmm. is the key. It's not necessarily a bad thing to be able to watch, you know, a kid's program or play a video game for a few hours. But I think a lot of times, a lot of people allow that to kind of go too far where mm-hmm. they now all of a sudden are disassociated with the family, or they're spending more time talking with a guy that they play a role play game in Australia with than they do their own parents.
Dog went again.
So, no.
But it's one of those things that I agree with the moderation, and depending on how you handle it, it could be a way to bring people together, show different points of view. I don't think it should become like a nanny or like a replacement mm-hmm. for a parent.
Sure, yeah.
Now, now you have more nanny options between video games, tablets, and TV, you know. So, all right. Anybody else want to share how their television watching scarred them as a child out over there? Anybody else? So, all right. Missy, there's a lot of events coming up. I know you're going to be teaching some social media tomorrow night at the Carnegie Library in Beachview, of course. So why don't you pull that microphone over to you so you can give us some of the lowdown here. I don't really have a camera. No, we can move this. We can kind of alter this. No, there you are. There you are. You're just not Katie. We'll just roll with that. Hey.
I've been the disembodied voice. I was fine with that.
There you go.
So yeah, we have the PodCamp Bootcamp automating your social media tomorrow. So I'll be teaching people how to set pretty much automated social media tweets and Facebook posts using schedulers. The 2017 STEM Summit is going to be at the Pittsburgh Tech Council. That's also tomorrow. There's a lot of stuff happening tomorrow. Because mm-hmm. We also have the 2017 International Hardware Cup Finals. That's going to be at Alpha Lab Gear tomorrow. And there is a Risky Business Small Business Legal Tips Seminar, also done by the Pittsburgh Tech Council. That is tomorrow as well. Explore the Floor at Gardner Denver Nash. That's by the Pittsburgh Tech Council. Not entirely sure what that is, but it's actually going to be at the Gardner Denver Nash location in Charleroi. So that's going to be a tech event that they're doing there, Explore the Floor. We have our Evening with PodCamp next week, the social media of politics. Brian is one of our
scheduled speakers
for that panel. We've also got a couple of other folks coming on, including one of our friends here in Beachview, Ashley Deemer, who's running for council, is going to be on the panel for that one.
Which council? Pittsburgh City Council?
Yeah, she's going to be running for our district. Co-creating in Pittsburgh, Creative Clash at Alpha Lab Gear on the 4th of May. So that is going to be at Alpha Lab Gear. That's being hosted by the Pittsburgh Tech Council. And I skipped over the co-creating in Pittsburgh, Creative Clash at Alpha Lab Gear. That's what I just said. Working together is working better, co-creation and innovation on the 3rd. That's the Pittsburgh Tech Council at the Pittsburgh Tech Council location. And then, of course, we've got the Millvale Music Festival coming up on the 13th of May. And that's the fun thing that Brian was talking about at the top of the show. So if you're just tuning in, make sure to listen back to the beginning of the show and check that out. And, of course, if you're in the area, stop by and check out the festival. And if you have anything that you'd like to have listed on our little social calendar over here, make sure to hit us up. Emails events@sorgatronmedia.com, and those will get to us and we can add them to our list.
There you go. Thank you very much for that. All right. On that note, like I said, Brian Crawford, you are at millvalemusic.org and riversedgepgh.com.
Yes. Pittsburgh's voice for local music.
There you go. And you have your show.
I do. My show is Monday, Wednesday, Friday, so I will be in tomorrow, Wednesday morning, 10 a.m. to 11 a.m., Thursday night, 7 p.m. for the Millvale Music Minute, and every first and third Saturday.
And you do put that out on a podcast stream for people that want to get you that way.
Yes, iTunes, SoundCloud, mm-hmm. Google Play, all of the big ones.
Tune in. And if you're wondering, and it's really easy to get tune in on your phone in your car. And it was actually funny because friends of ours at Black Forge Coffee were on KDKA a couple weeks ago,
mm-hmm.
and I was like, "Oh, I don't even know how to use my AM radio in this car," so I just pulled up TuneIn and saw KDKA was on air. I'm like, "All right, we're good to go."
Yeah,
you know, so it's right beside all the big wigs there. Of course, these guys bring us a little something different. John Chichilla at Chilla on the Twitter, ChillaTech.net.
That's where you can find me, John Chichilla on the Facebooks.
And Katie Dudas.
Hi. I'm everywhere now. I don't know. It'll be exciting now. Calm down. No more traveling.
Yeah, you would like. Well, yeah, we haven't actually won. You like spoke in front of people and stuff.
Yeah,
like you were on like a super important swanky panel or something.
Yeah, I was talking about haunted stuff.
Yeah,
Pittsburgh stuff. That was fun. I really like that. That was good.
You hung out in New York City last week.
Yeah, I was in New York City. We had some fun stops in New York City, and now I'm back home. It's so nice. Nice. Sleeping in my own bed is so nice again. But yeah, no, Scarehouse stuff, Scarehouse podcast, Scarehouse. That seems to be all right now.
And thank you, wife of the show, Missy, helping with production of the show at Rebellious Flaw on the Twitter. Bite me, PGH. For yummy things. I'm at Sorgatron on the Twitter. Check out everything. Again, we do this every Tuesday live at awesomecast.com or .net. And hit us up, of course, subscribe to the show, all the places you like your podcasts at. And a live stream is also on Facebook Live, including some pop-up interviews every once in a while for the awesome chat whenever we get those scheduled as well. Thank you to our awesome audience joining us in the chat room all night long. You've been our awesome audience. Have an awesome week. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at sorgatronmedia.com.